thanks so much, everybody, for joining. A safe climate, equal future tour. My name's Nina Crawley. I work for Oxfam Australia as an advocacy and campaigns lead, and I'll be very humbly moderating tonight's event. I'm just going to check on the whereabouts of our third speaker. But that's perfectly fine because we've got time for him. And while we wait for that, I'd love to tell you a little bit more about Oxfam's work and why we're organising tonight and introduce you to our speakers. So Oxfam's an international development organisation with a vision for an equal world. Through our programmatic work and through our Australian advocacy, we seek to tackle inequality head on. And so to do that, we work with what we see as the four main dimensions of inequality. So we work to uphold climate justice, gender justice, economic justice, and First Peoples rights and justice. I think many of us here would agree that climate change is the single greatest threat we see to equality and to, we've got these twin crises of worsening inequality and worsening climate crisis. And, we really need to come together to find some solutions for that. The science is really clear. There's, very little arguing with that now, and we would certainly all agree that we need to see rapid and significant decarbonisation within our societies. But we can't let this transition, through this transition, we can't repeat the mistakes of the past. We don't want a transition that's paternalistic, that's based around ideals of colonisation and that's greedy. We need to ensure this climate transition happens in a way that promotes inequality. Globally, we know we need $400 billion to meet the existing needs caused by climate loss and damage. This is, this is the crisis, this is the scale of the issue that our governments need to step up and solve. And that might sound like a huge number, and it is, but I can give you an even bigger number. Globally, governments are giving over $690 billion in fossil fuel subsidies. So we can do this if we focus on what's important. And I think we know that the inequality is clear, that the people who have done the least to cause this climate crisis are really on the forefront of the issues that we're facing. We know that small island states in the Pacific account for less than 0.5% of global emissions. And as I'm sure the speakers here tonight will elaborate, are facing some really drastic consequences. But these are also the communities that are leading global cooperation, that are leading adaptation, that are leading the innovation needed to transition us to this post-carbon future. And so that really brings us to our excellent speakers, and which is why Oxfam thought it was so important to invite them to Australia to speak with you folk, to speak with our decision makers, because they are at the forefront of leadership in climate action and in cooperation and innovation. So to my right, I have Lavenia Naivalu. She is the first woman to ever be elected as district leader to that role in Fiji. So she is a leader in her community. She's also a passionate climate change advocate. She is from a region profoundly affected by climate change and has personally experienced devastating consequences of cyclones and sea level rises. Since Cyclone Winston hit, Lavinia's been actively engaged in grassroots, national and international efforts to combat climate change. Through her efforts, she's called for greater global efforts to combat climate change, and especially in communities like hers. Maybe we'll give Lavenia a welcome. Next to Lavenia, we have Zedi Devesi. So Zedi is an advocate for climate change from the Solomon Islands. He has a strong connection to two communities, to Solofu and to Tanga. And Both these areas have been significantly impacted by climate change. The impacts of climate change hold a real personal significance for Zedi, as his family's communities are already having to start relocating to the mainland. Zedi's really motivated by the urgency of these climate crises, and he volunteers for a number of organisations working with Indigenous peoples and also with youth to combat this the climate crisis. And lastly, Usaia Moli, he from Fiji. His community has already had to relocate due to climate impacts. Zedi works tirelessly as a volunteer disaster responder, as a volunteer and volunteering as the vice president of FCOS, the Fiji Council of Social Service. He works to coordinate communities to respond to the climate crisis. He's seen firsthand the devastation caused by climate-induced disasters and is really motivated to prevent these in the future. Apologies, we didn't stop for an applause for Zedi, but please join me in welcoming all of our speakers. So tonight I'm going to invite each of our speakers to share their stories. I'll ask them a few questions and then we would love to take some questions from the floor and potentially online too. If people have any at the end. So first of all, Lavenia, I would ask, can you share your story? Which would you be more comfortable, sitting or standing?
Yes. Thank you. All right. Lavenia Yasikula Naivalu, Bulevilaka, ladies and gentlemen, meaning a very warm welcome to you all. I'm a bit nervous this evening, but I will try my best. I do not speak proper English, but I'm happy that I have two of my dear uncles with us today. They will be able to do the translation in the professional Australian language, and of course, Usa is there. A very warm welcome to guests that are invited to this auspicious event today, and of course those who are online with us, Bulavinaka to you all. Basically, I will talk about my district of Nadula, which I'm very proud of. It is very highly vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, of course. Small islands with limited area and even more limited area suitable for planting, very limited freshwater supply, and located on the dry side of Fiji and highly susceptible to droughts. Seawater inundation affecting freshwater supply, sea level rise, and storm surges eroding coastlines and threatening coastal villages. First islands in the Fiji group to be hit by annual cyclones. Nadula district lies directly in cyclone paths as they enter the Fiji waters. Annual impacts of storms, cyclones, droughts, and sea level rise and extreme heating events are affecting my community's livelihoods, our food and water, security and way of life. We are constantly trying to rebuild every year. In July 2023, the World Meteorological Organization confirmed the strong likelihood of an El Nino event in the tropical Pacific for the first time in 7 years, setting the stage for a likely surge in global temperatures and disruptive weather and climate patterns. This announcement followed the hottest June on record globally, where unprecedented sea surface temperatures and Antarctic sea ice loss were measured. This, coupled with overfishing, unsustainable coastal development, pollution, and other threats, calls for an urgent action and commitment from governments worldwide to commit to an urgent and equitable transition towards a fossil fuel-free economy. Yeah. COP31 presents a huge opportunity for the Australian government to strengthen partnerships with Pacific Island governments in a more meaningful way to equitably address the climate crisis that is in line with the Paris Agreement goal of below 1.5 degrees. My district of Nadula has a 20-year sustainable development plan, which further streamlines to plans for specific thematic areas. In other words, my fisheries management plan, mangroves management plan, and disaster risk reduction plan. This long-term and forward-thinking development plan guides us on how we will work collaboratively as a community to improve our standard of living in the face of a changing climate, loss of biodiversity, frequent natural disasters, pollution, social problems, health problems, etc., etc., etc. Our district development plans guides us on how we will adapt to the changing climates, respond and recover from disasters, and use our traditional knowledge and practices to ensure sustainable use and management of our oceans, land, and biodiversity, empower our women and girls, improve education, and many more. We are committed as a community, like many other communities in Fiji and the Pacific, to use climate-smart, nature-based solutions and natural knowledge to accelerate climate and ocean action for people and planet, even with our limited resources and the inequity we face. We hope that the Australian government and all of us here today is willing to do the same to show true leadership in aligning its global climate policies in line with the Paris Agreement goal of 1.5 degrees. As Australia and the Pacific bid for COP31, my community and I would like to request for the Australian government to consider the plight of my community and all other grassroots coastal communities in Fiji and the Pacific, including the plights of women and girls who are the most vulnerable. We cannot achieve our sustainable development aspirations if we have to continue to rebuild our communities year after year, month after month, from disaster to another. We would like to see that the roadmap to COP31 is inclusive of voices from my grassroots communities, youths, women and children from the Pacific in shaping a very ambitious COP31 outcome. We would also like to be actively involved in the planning process, activities, and using the momentum from COP28, 29, and 30 as stepping stones to drive ambition, showcase our climate actions at the community level using our traditional knowledge and nature-based solutions. We would also like to collaborate strongly with Australian Indigenous people and local voices on global stages. Our community, including those from Australia, Solomon Islands, and Papua New Guinea, got together in Cairns last year for the first inaugural regional forum for Oceania First Voices in September. From this conference, there was an outcome document which was widely advocated at the UNFCCC in Egypt, and that was COP27. Such regional forums is driven by Indigenous people, and it's a great opportunity to learn from each other while speaking with one voice on issues that needs to be addressed to ensure the security of our land, sea, biodiversity, people, and the way we live. We would also like to see that the Australian government support this partnership and expand to cover more Indigenous communities from Australia and the Pacific in the lead up to COP31. We would also like to see meaningful partnerships between Australia and the Pacific in the true spirit of Unisue, which is Wovale. Financial support from community-led projects, policies, and commitments. More youth engagement and programs to support my community forward thinking and investment in a long activity of engagements. I will share with you some of the insights or contribution of women back home in the fisheries sector. Every day when the weather permits, my fellow fisherwoman in the village in my district goes out fishing for fish, collect shellfish, and crabs and many other types of seafood to feed our families, sell to earn money to pay for our children's education, medicine, and many more. We go fishing in the nearby reefs, mangrove swamps, mudflats, seagrass beds. We also process and cook the fish that our husbands catch, and we also sell the fish for income too. Grassroots women play a very important and crucial role in the fisheries sector. We definitely contribute to food security, to eradicating hunger and poverty, contribute to economic growth, and also rebuild resilient nations. However, our contribution is still underrecognized, undocumented, and our voices are silenced by all other voices in the climate space. We struggle to be included in decision-making processes that affect our ability to fish, to feed, and support our families, our communities, and our nation. I will speak maybe on some of the challenges and difficulties that we women in the grassroots face. My district of Ladula has a 20-year-based sustainable development plan. One of the key focus of this plan, especially empowering women and girls in our district, we, the community, came together as a collective on this sustainable development plan. And one of the priorities of this plan is to empower women and girls in my district. Women's contribution to the fisheries sector is largely undocumented and unrecognized, which I have already mentioned. We still face a lot of challenges in terms of participating in decision-making processes that affect the way we live, that affect the way we fish and our ability to fish. However, we have been empowered by a lot of NGOs like Oxfam, of course, WWF Pacific, and more organizations and corporates through increased awareness, training, and capacity building. They have also created an opportunity for us women to be part of decision-making in our villages in a very open, transparent, and inclusive manner. How do we need to be supported and strengthened? I will need you to listen to us first and amplify our voices. We need stronger policies and legislations that will provide enabling conditions that protect our human rights as women, and for the full and meaningful participation of all women, youth, and girls in decision-making processes, implementation of ocean action, monitoring, and also access to equitable benefits. We are calling on the global community to invest in grassroots women so that we can be empowered and effectively contribute to ocean action, climate action, and fisheries management. We need support to connect with our small-scale fisher women to share experiences and learn from each other. Overall, I believe that the Blue Pacific continent is a continent of, it could be used as a solution, as a continent of solutions for the continent. So if we are working to protect the Blue Pacific, we are also going to protect the Blue Continent. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Lavinia. And I'm sure I have many questions to ask you. I'm sure you all do, but we're going to hear from all of our speakers first. So, Zedi, if you would like to share with us some of your story and your perspectives.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Zedi Vahia Devesi, and I come from a very humble lineage of artificial island builders. I know many of you might not know what is an artificial island, but I'll explain to you. So back in the days, we call the days of our ancestors, hundreds of years ago, we developed this system called, we developed this building system called building islands in the coastal areas of Malaita province. And we'd usually take corals and shrimps on the ocean, and we build up reefs and use them as fishing grounds for our indigenous peoples. And these practices have been practiced for many years until passed down all the way to our generation today. But as of now, we're slowly losing our home, our artificial island that I'm from, which is called Sulufo. Every single day we wake up, we look outside, the seawaters are almost close to our houses. And these houses, if you guys think, are not made from bricks and irons. These are cultural, traditional houses, which we take wood from the forest and we weave the, what? I don't know the English name for it, but the leaves from the banana tree, then we use it to build this type of houses. Now, these type of houses are just wooden houses, as you can see, and only made for situations that are not really common to the climate. So as we've experienced, as people in my community experience, due to sea level rises, they tend to rot the host of the houses, causing them to be easily broken from small winds and just little raindrops, just rains and things like this. And not only that, because of climate change, the water that we used to go fish on becomes warmer. So some species of fish were not able to be found because they need to be a certain type of temperature to find this type of fish. And it affects our ecosystem and also our fishing ideologies, our traditional ideologies. Because like when we say, okay, this is the place we're going to fish and we're gonna find this type of certain fish. When we go to this type of places, we're gonna find this type of certain fishes. But because of the warmth of the water, some those fishes are no longer, they cannot inhabit those places, making it difficult for us to go and look for those type of certain fishes. So we have to move further away, further to places that are not from our tribe. And you might ask, why not relocate? Why not move to the places that like our mainland, that can survive this type of weather? Well, it's very difficult for us because since we practice building artificial islands, and since we've been living in these artificial islands for a very long time, we are seen as people of this island. And if we are to go to the mainland, it's going to be very difficult because there's other tribes that are living in the mainland. So then we have land disputes, and we have cultural differences, and that will also lead to traditional losses, because you can't practice another tradition in another person's cultural, because they'll be seen as disrespectful to them. So that's why it's very difficult for us, especially in my concern, is the youth. The traditional practices that we usually practice from our fathers and from our mothers will not be able to pass down to some of our youths. Because how can you practice this type of harvesting of fishes when there's no fishes that are found in this type of areas? So this type of traditional knowledges will be gone, you know? And it also goes down to building this type of houses. Everyone has certain kind of traditional gifts passed down from family to family. Some certain families know how to read the weather. Some certain families know how to see which seafood is best to eat. And this type of knowledge is going to be gone. So we're not only losing this land, but we're also losing ourselves, our identity. That's why it's very important for us to not only consider adults, but also kids that are coming up, youths today, to encourage them to fight for climate change and to fight for what they believe in, because their identity, their cultural heritage depends on it. Thank you very much. My name is Zedi.
And I would invite Usaia to stand and share with us his story and thoughts before questions.
A lot of more people that are there online.
Is it good day or good day?
I might.
Still trying to.
Right. Good day, everyone. And I hope you're all doing well. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge and offer my respect to the traditional custodian of the land on which we gather today. Pay my respect to their elders, past and present, and extend my greetings to any First Nation people who may be with us here today. I have also offered greetings from Fiji, from the three confederacy of Kumbuna, Burimasanga, and Pawata, and also greetings from my organization, which counts of social services and those that we work with in the country. From all the running around we've been doing in the last few days, I completely forgot that it was my birthday today. Until they brought out a cake this afternoon. Thank you so much for that. And instead of that, somebody called and said, this week is Father's Day. I have 7 kids waiting for me at home. I'm not trying to make a rugby team, but but thank you so much for having us here. I'm being reminded again. Thank you for coming. In the Pacific and in Fiji, our culture is very much instilled in all of us as we grow up. And second to this is religion, and that is right. So we're still celebrating what Fiji did. But I'm being reminded, I was born on the 31st, 8, 1979. Yes, the white hair shows. On the Bible, Proverbs 31st, 8, it says, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of those who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly, defend the rights of those that are poor and in need. I don't think I'm here by accident, even though I keep telling Nina, I pick up this few years back, the work with climate change. But I don't think that we are here by accident in terms of the work and in terms of the effort that we put in looking after our people. Thank you very much, Oxfam, for taking up the this challenge and providing a platform that are usually occupied by regional and international NGOs for us to tell a story of change, of adaptations, of resiliency. Many of our communities are forgotten, and while they work in silence, mitigating what climate change has brought to our doorstep. As William Cooper did for the First Nation, you have provided us with an opportunity to highlight our work as activists, as a campaigner, a humanitarian worker, social worker, advocate, lobbyist, a youth, a fisherwoman, and most importantly, a truth teller. This kind of opportunity do not always come very often, but when we're given an opportunity, we'll make sure that we'll do as much as we can to highlight our story. In 2009, Fiji got hit by two cyclones, Tisi Asa and Tisi Ana. And I was given a task by my organization, Fiji Council of Social Services, to lead a CSO team to Mbua province. The devastation and the things that we see on the ground will remain with me for the rest of our life, for my life. One of the villages that we went to, called Gongea, whatever was left by these two Category 5 cyclone was taken away by floods from two streams that are beside it. And as we got back from the two-month work that we did as first responder, I said, you know, while we often put climate change issue as an agenda on the table, people are actually living with it. People are actually going through it, and it's time to take it seriously as well. And the Fiji Council of Social Services, with their 18 district councils that are scattered all over Fiji, and also our 280 community-based organizations, we are the first responders. And we are the one in the community that is quietly adapting and also practicing some of our knowledge passed down by our forefathers in terms of building resilience in our communities. In the next few days, here in Australia, and as we go into meetings tomorrow and go into Canberra in the next few days, I'm going to ask the government to start looking towards the Pacific to look at national coordinating mechanisms that are available regionally and nationally as well. These are the ones that link directly to communities, to volunteers, to first responder, like my brother Zedi from Solomon, like my sister from Yasawa, and there are others. We are here standing on the shoulders of so many great people that have done a lot of work in the past. And I was telling Zedi just before this, I'm really happy that we met on Monday with a lot of Pacific climate warriors and young people that are taking up this issue, because as I told him, if you are going to make plans for tomorrow, it's only right to include those that are going to be there. We need to work together, provide more platform, not only at the national level, but also in the last few days, I've been reminded how a lot of work need to happen at the international, at the regional level. You are the one with the power to amplify our stories, as Lavenia have just mentioned. You have the power to move and open up a lot of these spaces, so a lot more stories can be told. All we have is stories. You are the one that can push this and hopefully open doors where we can come and talk to those in power. So at least when it's time to change this, those policy, we need people that have the political will to be able to do that. Because a lot of times they go on, put in communique and sometimes policy and everything, they say yes, but not much commitment and a lot of no contribution have been put on it. COP 31 is an opportunity that we can work together on, and I'm hoping that we'll see a lot more of this kind of collaborations and this kind of space being available for those in the Pacific to actually come and participate so you can hear their stories. Before I sit down, I was asked, I think it was yesterday, what does climate change and climate justice mean to you? I said, everything. As a baby, when you're born, as soon as your umbilical cord, or what we call pito, fall, they will take it, they will either throw it to the sea, or they usually bury it in the land together with a certain plant. For us, we have, in all the communities, we have a totem. I have a bird, I have a tree, I have a fish, and these are most common in all Pacific and all First Nation people. When we talk about relocation, when we talk about climate change, this is what we are fighting for. There are species that are getting extinct every now and then, as you can hear from Zed. When we talk about relocation, why is it so hard for people to move? Why, if the sea is coming, you should move? It's not about moving structures. We have a lot of roots, a lot of, it's about our culture and our identity that are there with land. And this is one of the reasons why a lot of work that need to happen in the community, when we, there's a lot of talk on loss and damage, these are the things that you need to keep in mind while we do this. Thank you, Oxfam, for providing us with this space. And as I said, there's a lot more work, there's a lot more that Australia can contribute. And I reiterate my message to the Australian government, saying there's a need for a lot more support for national coordinating mechanism at regional, at national level, to organizations such as the Fiji Council of Social Services that work directly with first responders, with the community, because they are the ones that are making those changes. They are the experts on the issue that they are going through. They have the solution. And a lot of times, somebody needs to be there to ask the right questions.
so much, Usaia. Please have a think about what questions you might like to ask. I'll ask a few and then definitely open it up to the floor. I wanted to pick up on something you just said, Usaia, which was that all we have is our stories. And while I can understand the sentiment there, and I can understand the need to compel others to use their political will and their resources to support in this fight, I think that you're being very humble. So I think what we see and increasingly are seeing more and more is that actually many Pacific nations have been at the forefront of international coordination and are also the people who are coming up with the solutions and the innovations. Lavenia, I know we've been speaking over this past few days about your work with fisheries. So I'd love to hear more from you maybe about the innovations that that women are coming up with to support and to still be able to fish in their traditional lands, some of the challenges they're facing. And I was very interested to hear about your traditional role within your community. And I think a lot of people here would be really interested for you to share that as well and why protecting fisheries is so important for you.
Vinaka, for your question, when you first introduced me, you mentioned that I was the first woman to be appointed to the role of a district representative back in Fiji. The role of the district representative sounds so big. Basically, my work is to administer 7 traditional villages, 2 informal settlements, coordinating with 12 island resorts in the region. So when it comes to projects, I look after water. I'm making sure my highest priority of work in the region is making sure that my people will have or drink safe and clear and clean drinking water. So my role, I am a community lead and I'm a convener. A child of Nadula, of course, a mother, coordinating and safeguarding and spearheading needs and interests of the people of Nadula and neighboring districts where I can. And of course, challenges aside from the ones you know of, climate change being the biggest one, in an isolated geographical location of Nadula, impacting everything, including cost of living, education, etc., etc. Ignorance and lack of knowledge. I would like to share with everyone one of my highest priority of work at home. And of course, my Vasu, who has just entered the room this morning, will know very well the water crisis that we face back home. I was sharing with an audience yesterday, made up of CEOs of major non-governmental organizations around Victoria, a dream that I had the previous night. We were talking with it amongst ourselves, and I was not concentrating on the work that I was doing. Uso was asking me questions I wouldn't know how to answer. Zedi was asking me questions I wouldn't know. And I was sharing with the audience yesterday, I had a bad dream the previous night and made me woke up at about 4 a.m. in the morning, and I couldn't sleep until it was daylight. Maybe because I was thinking of my children back home. Talking on the water crisis issues back home, due to climate change, there is shortage of water. Our water sources are running dry every day. So I had this dream where my sons, this is reality. They wake up every morning. Their norm is to go to the hand-dug well or beside our home and fetch out water to have a bath and then to go to school. So in this dream, I saw that my children were trying to fetch out water from the well and there was no water. And then they went to the rainwater harvest tank beside home and they opened the tap. This I was seeing in my dream. They opened the tap and there was no water. And me thinking, And then they called me and said, "Mom, there is no water. Is it because I did not go to Sunday school on Sunday and God is angry with me? Me standing here in front of all of you, I'm kindly accommodated at one of the big hotels in Australia, in Sydney, opening the tap, just standing up beside my bed is the tap. And thinking back of the struggle my children are facing back home, what did they do wrong? Where is the justice? We did not build any tall buildings. We did not build any big factories. We are not dumping any nuclear waste to the sea. Why does my children deserve all this? Where is the climate justice? The Australian government, where is our fair share of climate finance? We hear so much of climate finance. Where is climate finance? I will only believe of climate finance if the financing or the assistance or funding of the water projects in my village is at my doorstep, then I will believe that climate finance is at my doorstep." Does that answer your question?
Thank you, Lavenia. Yes.
I will answer another question from the audience.
Oh, I might just ask Zedi again. Thank you, Lavenia. We can do some, and then the audience can ask, they can take us all the way to the end. Usaia, I want to ask you a question. You're welcome to sit here. Everybody can hear us fine. There's mics in the roof for online.
Tall enough.
or if you prefer to stand, totally up to you. And I want to pick up on something you were just saying at the end there, Lavenia. You know, where is the climate finance? Certainly through a lot of the research work we do at Oxfam Australia, we hear and we see that locally led solutions aren't being given the funding and the recognition that they need. And Sire, I know that you talk about coordination and how important that is. And through your work with EFCOS, you're working with grassroots communities. So I wonder if you could tell me a little, and maybe you have some examples, you know, why is it so important to have the grassroots communities involved in coordination? And why is it so important to have them leading the projects that are supporting climate adaptation and disaster resilience within their communities?
Naka. I've mentioned before, when it comes to any disaster, it'll take a lot of time for government to actually reach your community. There's a lot of trees that need to be cut down, there's a lot of traveling, and there's a lot of planning that need to happen before any of that do happen. In one of our training in Suba, there's 9 clusters. There are those that look after wash, there are those that look after shelter. And we've been asked, when do you get activated? So usually the shelter will say, until government have said that this much house is gone, so now you can go. And they asked the district council, when do you get activated? We say, as soon as the first branch fell, as soon as the first tin roof fly, we get activated. As soon as the rain start passing, there's a post, you'll see markings, because we know when it reach here, the first house from that corner is underwater. We have started looking and we've started adapting to what's happening in our community, because we see these changes every single day. We are the expert when it comes to our issue on the ground. And if there's plan that's going to be done, consultations need to be done with those that are there as well. Now, we have been working when it comes to any disaster. We usually are the first one that put in our pictures, send in our reports, because those that are reporting are coming from the communities, those that are there. We do as much as we can to do this training so that they can be empowered. We do as much as we can to give them a little bit of fun for their phones so that it can be activated as well. We do as much as we can, but then there are times that, because there's not a lot of funding that goes into coordinations. Usually it goes a lot into programming. And just like Lavenia have said, you know, a lot of these bilateral agreements between government. I was asked yesterday why is a lot of ministers are coming to the Pacific.
Yes, but those agreements are done behind closed doors, and communities, we don't know anything about it. Because unless we see this materialize in our doorstep, in our community, then only then that we know that our big brother Australia have our back. Then I can tell my children, yes, you have somebody up there that is looking out for you as well. Because right now, I cannot take her to the beach where she usually goes, because the mud is now up to her ankle. Right, the things that I enjoy when I was young, I cannot take them. I cannot take her there now. There were fish. They usually come annually into our shores. We don't see that anymore. We usually can tell what the weather is by looking at birds. Those birds are gone. These are the little things that we are slowly losing, and these cultural things that we usually that are told to us by our forefathers. I cannot reiterate to often as Zedi have said, because all of these things are gone. But the work, but if you go to communities, believe me, they'll smile at you. They will invite you into their home. They will share their food with you, because we are resilient people. We are resilient people, and we'll adapt and we'll keep working towards this. As I said, these changes were brought to our doorstep. It's not something that we brought for on ourselves, but we all have a part to play in terms of mitigating all of this. Naka.
Thank you, Usaia. And Zedi, you spoke really powerfully, I think, about what the loss of land and the loss of culture meant. I was wondering if you could speak to some of the work you're doing to support people through your work with an Indigenous Peoples Organisation. And I think that maybe provides some really strong examples of what it looks like when a community is getting the support they need for their specific needs. So yeah, if you could share some of the biodiversity work, that would be great.
So the Network of Indigenous People is the organisation I work for. And what we usually do is we set up awareness. We set up workshops in rural communities who have not much access to the information that are coming from the towns and cities and things like this. So we do workshops in schools, educating young kids so that they can also be aware of what is going on around the environment. So they don't have to question, oh, why am I not going to school? Because it's too rainy and things like this, yeah. Just so they can be like, oh, it's like this because of this and that. And I think, and I believe so much in educating young kids in rural and kids in cities, because like when kids are more aware of their environment, they are more to take care of it as they grow up. And like we say, kids are like sponge, yeah? So when we tell them information, they gather it in and then they soak it in and then they put it with them and then they carry them throughout life. And that's what we want to do. So in my organization, we go to schools such as St. Nicholas College, and after we organize these workshops to educate kids of how they can contribute to society and to also climate change and to fight against it.
Thank you so much. I would really love if there's any questions on the floor. Online participants, you're welcome to submit questions in the chat. So somebody's watching the chat and he can ask your questions on your behalf. Now, is there anybody in the room who had any questions for our wonderful speakers?
That might be a political question, Zedi. Solomon Islands recently signed a big finance deal with China. Is there any chance that you might see some climate action finance coming from that? Do you know anything about that?
I believe climate change. And climate change is a global issue, and it shouldn't be only for one country and this. But right now, I'm in Australia, and I'm talking with Australians, so I am pretty sure this is the appropriate time to say it.
I think my question, or probably my statement, would like to address to thank the three panelists who gave their contribution today. It really challenges me. I'm a Fijian, I'm actually Lavenia's uncle, And what came out of this, of their presentation today, is what we now see, there is a lack of participation to at the top level by the government, not just in the Pacific Island government, but also by more of the first world countries who have contributed a lot to those damage, which we are now suffering the consequences. To Usaia, okay, would you please share with us the impacts of the relocation of your village? Because I, for those of you who may not be aware, there's a lot of intricacies that happens when you relocate. You just can't relocate to another piece of land, because everyone, like in the Solomon Islands, in Fiji, everyone is tribal to their own piece of land. And also to our, what do we call, Angolingoli. We can only access those places for our fishing. And being relocated means we are intruding into someone else's fishing rights, into their land management system. So I'd just like probably Zedi and Usaia can share with us the experiences of the relocation of their villages and how they have been able to adapt with those tribal cross-lining between those different tribes in a village.
For this one, I'll stand.
The relocation in the Kobo and Mawala was done even before my grandfather. But we're currently, FCOS is currently piloting a first community-led relocation. The community in Nambavatu in Mazuata right now, they're still intent living in a playground in Raketi because the land that they own is not suitable for a village. So they are still waiting for government to assist them so that they can be relocated to maybe a state land or maybe a negotiation with other communities as well. But I can tell you about the experience that we have from Vangea, the village that I said that got hit by two cyclones and also flooded by two rivers that were beside them. Community relocation is done, and every step and every decision that is need to be done is done together with the two Yavusa, or the two clans that are there. One of the Yavusa is the one that they actually give the land where they're in right now. And also the community also gave their timber so that we can swap it together with the Fiji hardwood so that they can provide the mahogany where we're able to build a house as well. There are concerns that are raised by women in terms of where will they do the washing, how is the sewerage is going to be done, and the children, if they have anywhere to play. And in our villages, there are systems where you put the Walni Songo or the community hall, where you will put the church, and how the clan or the tokotoka will actually be placed as well. These are all the things that we work with them and they all approve. From putting the proposal together, we sat with them until they were okay with it, then we send it over. From the plan, from the civil work and everything that needs to be done is done together with the community. Right now we are at the civil work is starting, and we are partnering up with some of the ministry and government. At the same time, there's a lot of, for the first time in terms of climate change, we're also looking at the mental part of it, because a lot of these children and women, they're still traumatized. And we're getting CSOs and NGO as well to come in to work on this as well. As I said, relocation is not about just moving the structure. There's a lot of decision and there's a lot of work that come into play. And one of the things that we prioritize is at every level, the community need to be consulted, because at the end of the day, we'll finish the work, we'll move out, government finish, they'll move. They are the ones that are going to be there to occupy these houses. Mm. So that's currently what we're doing. We are also collecting all the learnings. Hopefully we'll put out a handbook as well. And we're looking at the standard operating procedures, and we are helping government to put all of this in a lot of policies, so that is a learning not only for the Fiji, for Fiji, but also for the Pacific. Maybe it's something that we can all learn from.
Okay.
Sandy, did you want to respond to that question? It was for you also. Did you want to respond to your experience of relocation? I'm sorry, I don't know if you wanted to repeat the part of the question for Zedi. Yeah.
Okay. The what I was hearing from your presentation, there seems to be a similarity of the issues, the social and the cultural issues being faced in the Solomon Islands as we are facing in Fiji. Because we, as you're saying, when the water is warm, the fishes are not there, you can't just go into another tribal fishing ground. And that was more of my statement of what I was picking up from their presentation this afternoon. Thank you.
And I also believe that just goes to show like how connected we are as Pacific Islanders and as people of ocean. Yeah. So we share the same beliefs, same values. A little similar, yeah?
Yes. Thank you.
Inaka.
Thank you. I might just ask Lavinia to come in on that last one because I was hearing Usaia speaking to the experience of women in that relocation process, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on some of the particular challenges women face when land changes, when their villages aren't able to provide what they used to. And I think that you've got a really strong, specific example of moving community infrastructure and not getting the support that you need. So I thought you might want to speak to your health centre also.
Back home, with the issue of relocation, of course, due to climate change, rising sea level, not only we are going to relocate the actual houses, and from my perspective as a woman, our food security to back home are being severely affected. Root crops that were producing in big sizes during my grandfather's days are no more. They are growing smaller and smaller. That is with food security. And with the limited resources that I have back home, I have an example. I have set up a yam seed bank. I've used the COVID period to set up yam seed banks. So apparently, I would say that the COVID pandemic was a blessing in disguise to the Fijian people, especially to my community. It has taught us and taught my community to manage our natural resources wisely, because this is what we will fall back on in times of crisis. COVID was only the beginning of many, many more crises. So as a woman and as a community lead, sometimes I do not sleep when I think of how I will feed my 2,000 plus men and women back home, especially with the agriculture sector, with food security. And I've been setting up traditional marine protected reserves in all villages and all resorts around the region, so that we use this in times of crisis. Does that answer your question, Nina?
Yeah, although did you want to speak to how difficult it's been to move your health center?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
And also, the health center back home is one of my main priorities at the moment. We have been in consultation with government about this health center for the past decade, since 2009. We have been talking about relocation, and we are hearing of climate finance. Come to a time, I've said I'm exhausted. I don't know who is listening and who is talking. And I've been exhausted of fighting. The health center back home is just people from home that are in the audience today. They will agree with me. It's just 3 meters away from the door of the clinic. So that is how serious the effects of climate change is at home. And then maybe in the next 2 years, that clinic, there are a few houses that are in line with that clinic that are 100, 200 meters away, that are half to the sea and half to the land. So we have relocated these families in the past year. So in the next 2 years, that hospital will be going to the sea. So here I am, and of course we will be going into Canberra, and we are meeting government political leaders tomorrow, and going to Canberra on Monday. I believe that someone there would be able to help my community-based projects back home.
Question? Okay. My name is Teresa. I'm currently intern with the Edmund Rice Center here in Sydney. I'm Tuvalu and Fijian, but I currently live and reside in Tuvalu. So thank you so much for your presentations. I could relate to a lot of examples that was provided. So my question is along the lines, with Australia's bid to host COP31, regardless of the outcome, what more would you like to see from the Australian government? And if not the Australian government, non-government organisations within Australia, and what more would you like to see from them, and how they could collaborate or NGOs such as yours in Fiji and around the Pacific region?
So, do you like to answer?
I guess in the last few days, we were calling on a lot more support from Australia in terms of climate financing. They have signed on to a lot of policies, but they haven't committed any dollars into it as well. They have indicated in terms of how much they want to cut down on emission, but they haven't really make a dent on that. But this, the COP31 is an opportunity for CSOs, the international and the regional, to come together, as I said, to amplify the stories that are coming from the Pacific, from First Nation people, from communities, from first responders, from climate warriors that are there, that are telling their stories. It's an opportunity for a lot more collaborations, because for some of these voices also to be heard, a lot of times, somebody need to turn this down so that the one here can actually, their voice can actually reach here. Sometimes we are crowding the space. There's not a lot of voice that are coming from there, because as I said, this space is, we don't usually come and occupy this space. Usually the ones that can write the best proposal usually sit here. That's why we keep thanking Oxfam for being forward thinking in terms of providing this kind of spaces. And allowing us to be here, and we hope that in the next few days that we're here, we not only will share our stories, but also share the stories of the First Nation people and the struggles that they are going through here, the struggle of the West Papua, and the struggles and the fight that we have in Fiji. Just last week, we are marching because of the nuclear dumping that is happening. There is a lot, and we can get Australia to commit to this when we're heading towards COP31. Yesterday I was asked if I want to go to COP28. I said my energy would be much better used if I go back to my community and start preparing for COP31. We can shape that in terms of to be the image of the Pacific. We can make it a Pacific COP31. And we right now we can start working with the politicians that are there that will make the final decisions. And we are paving the way with Oxfam in these next few days. So hopefully those that will come after us will continue to give pressure to that as well. And hopefully comes COP31, the Pacifica, the Oceania family, the First Nation people will be sitting together here to talk about our issues as well.
Lavenia, did you, because that was an open question, did either of you want to add? No problem if Usa said it all.
Yeah.
There was a question in the front earlier.
Yeah, I was going to ask, thank you so much, all of you, for great talks. Can I ask about young people? So I guess for Zedi first, but you will all, you're all part of families, that's right. Well, no, but you've got kids. So, in Australia, a lot of young people are really getting anxious about their future. So people like me will pass away, but my kids and my grandkids will have a much harder time because of the climate impact that they're going to face, even just here, and that's much less severe than what you're facing already. So I'm wondering if there are, after you talked about having classes and educating young kids, is there a concern rising among young people in the Solomons? Are there young people who are expressing, asking questions or expressing concerns, and then in Fiji too, about climate change, about the impact on them and in their lifetime?
From my work, when we do work, we usually ask them, like, do you know what's climate change? First, we do this first. We do this kind of exercise. We ask them, do you know what climate change is? They said, no, they don't know what climate change is. So then we start educating them on what climate change is. So the first thing we should do is educate our kids first so that they can know what climate change is. Because when they are aware of what climate change is, they can have a voice on what climate change is. But they're actually very scared after every single time we talk with them. And after they seem to ask, like, what's going to happen, you know? There's an uncertainty over there, you know? Maybe they're going to go and then they're going to find out that there's going to be more cyclones and then it's going to destroy the roads to them for them to have access to their schools. Maybe they can go to the universities in Solomon Islands because big change of weather patterns takes it down, and then after there's going to be more expenses for them to go to college in overseas. So these are the type of worries these kids might. I don't know what they're thinking, but that's what they tell me, like, what's going to happen, you know? So that's probably the most things I've always heard.
That's the sort of thing kids hear, same sort of, same sort of thing. Yeah.
I wish to add on to what Zedi had mentioned about your questions was the worry for the youths. Back home, I would say, due to climate change, we are not living a normal life back home. As I've already mentioned, during my grandfather's days, they would sit along the coastline and throw out their fishing line to fish for their family meal. Nowadays, my children are walking miles to go and fish for a proper meal at home. Youths, there is a big drift going on at the moment where youths are moving to cities, moving overseas to get a formal employment to feed their families because of this climate crisis. That is one of the major issues too. We are planning to table, to put it on the table while in Canberra at Parliament House, is to ask the Australian government to give a climate visa to Pacific nations. And not only that, but apparently my worry as a community lead, when there is a big movement, a drift of youths moving away from villages, traditional knowledges that the village elders have to pass down to the next generation, there is a big gap from the elders to the children, the youths, this age gap, there will be a big age gap. I do not know who these traditional knowledges will be passed down to. People are running away from their villages because of climate change. And there will be a big loss of traditional knowledge. I'll share, I was called to lead a few weeks before COVID hit Fiji. And I was doing my research around the village. Only 3 women knew how to start a proper Yasawa mat where I am from. And I had used the COVID period to bring back the knowledge, bring these 3 ladies and collect all the women from the village, sit down and learn. The threat is, what if these 3 women will go tomorrow? Who will these 3 women, who will have the knowledge of this, of starting a traditional Yasawa mat? Okay, now, because of climate change, these youth, these young women are also are moving away again from the villages. The knowledge is drifting away. Did I answer your question?
No, that's really helpful. So it's not just the whole village moving. It's what's happening before that.
Yes.
As people are being forced to
move. To move because of climate change. They are looking for better ways.
I'm there are two kinds of schools of thought on COP31. One is, you know, let's have it here, then we have a reason to put pressure on our Australian government to be more accountable. And the other one is, let's withhold support for Australia hosting COP31, because then we have more leverage, and let's face it, is it just window dressing for the Australian government? They're not really honouring their commitment under the Paris Agreement. So what do you support? Or do you have a view, or maybe you haven't formed one?
I think right now there's two off on the table. It's either Turkey or Australia. And for the Pacific countries, which one will be better, which one will be easier? We are calling for no visa for the Pacific so that we can all come and tell our stories. This opportunity is for us to show the other countries out there, those that are going to be here, the big countries that are contributing that are going to be here as well. Let them hear it from us. Let them hear our story, let them see our pictures and our video for them to see exactly what's going on. Because a lot of time what comes to their doors are advocates and activists that read things online, that collect data. And it's time to put the human stories into the numbers and into the statistics that usually come up to them. And this is the opportunity that we have. And I was part of the NGOs and CSO meeting last week on Friday, where we're gathering in Suva after the departure of the two climate change ministers from New Zealand and Australia, in talking about our points that we will bring to the government, that we will work with the government to start looking towards committing to in the next few years as we lead up to this. A lot of times when we talked last week, we said sometimes it's about perspective. Sometimes we are divided in the Pacific because we are all fighting or dipping from the same pot. It's about time we don't call ourselves small nation countries, but the big ocean that represents us, which is the Oceania. This kind of perspective will put a little difference in terms of our negotiation power that will go towards this table. It's not only Australia, but to the global as well. It's an opportunity for us to introduce the world to what the true Oceania is and to what is uniquely the Pacific and the Oceania to the world, so that they can see what the emissions or the damage that have happened, where is actually ending up, and that is in the biggest oceans that are here with us, that connect us all. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Zedi, did you want to respond?
No question.
Which is strategically the better move, to withhold COP from Australia, to force them to do better, and to show that we think, you know, historically they've been a terrible actor in the climate space, or to have COP here so that we can use that as leverage to force the Australian government to do better?
I don't know about you guys, but me, I'd like to hold them as leverage, because these guys have been talking too much about partnership and everything like that, but it hasn't been shown. And me, as a youth of the Pacific, you know, I need to see now. I can't wait another 6 years, another 7 years. These plans are not really reality for us. We're really moving. Our population is rising as youth as well. We need it now, and we need it now. So I'll hold leverage to Australia. If you want to hold copia, honor your commitments. Thank you.
Namaste, Bula. My name is Hasmuk. I'm from Fiji as well. Just wanted to pick up on Thea's question earlier. Just wondering whether some of the states in Australia have very strong anti-protest laws. And I know that in the COP space, there's space for civil society to protest so that they can show support and share their stories. I'm wondering whether any of that will factor into your decision to come to Australia, should we be successful in hosting a conference party in 2026?
We have been talking with CEOs of non-governmental organizations yesterday, and there's one interesting one, which is Get Up. I think you've heard of them. Members of about 5.5 million from Indigenous people all over Australia, and we are having a gathering in Cairns in the month of October. So I believe this is the platform where we will use to connect with each other and find ways and solutions or a way forward to this issue.
One of the things that I can remember from yesterday talking with the First Nation people, there will be protest. They said that in the last COP, they're introducing new things such as nature-based solution. And they say, if you're serious about nature-based solution, please give us back our land. Second, acknowledge the indigenous knowledge that are there. You need to acknowledge this as well. And for Fiji, fruit picking is not climate financing. Right? I mean, there's definitely going to be a lot of protests that are going to be there, and you might see us sitting on one of those tents. Well.
Naka.
I think that should be a t-shirt slogan, fruit picking is not climate financing.
I have a concern which is resonates with what Lavenia has mentioned. The loss of traditional knowledge coming about through climate change. She's mentioned the women's perspective of how it affects the women. And I'm gonna share with you guys my concern from the men's perspective. In our islands in the west of Fiji, near Saus, we are hit first when it's on the cyclone path. We are the first, or sometimes when it starts from the east, we will end up in the west. In terms of our traditional knowledge of housing, in our village, there's no buris. There's no traditional buri, meaning that everyone has now resorted to concrete or wooden houses because buris does not withstand cyclones. And my concern is my fear that traditional knowledge will be lost. The man who built houses will not be able to pass it down to their sons, and the sons will not be able to pass it down to their grandsons. So it is it's a real fear that silently permeating through our society. It's all, and there's a lot of other things that climate change has brought about into our social structure. Thank you.
Did anybody want to? I know it was a statement that. Zedi, you were speaking to me, or you were speaking earlier about how different families hold different knowledges. Did you want to respond to some of that cultural loss? And maybe is there things you've seen for people to preserve that knowledge? Is there things your community is doing?
Like we say, practice makes perfect, yeah? So to preserve these knowledges, we try to encourage kids to learn more, to be educated from their mothers, from their grandfathers. Some of us in the villages, we still have strong, powerful grandmothers and grandpa who just sitting down and things like this and just waiting for the kid. So there's also kids in the rural areas who are now learning after we have workshops in these areas, who are now learning from their grandmothers and their aunties and their uncles. And that brings much joy because they're practicing this type of traditional knowledge, and hopefully they can pass it on to their kids as well and their kids after. Thank you.
Just add on to Zedi. I'll be speaking a lot about examples from home. with traditional knowledge. On World Food Day last year, I visited all the schools. There's about 6 schools in my district. And I was speaking to the head teachers of the schools and asking them, on World Food Day, there's no funding whatsoever that came from government. And again, on limited resources that we have. I've asked the teachers if on World Food Day, all students will come to school with either a root crop or a seashell or fish for them to come and prepare a traditional Nadula meal. And then the high school boys came with firewood and everything. And then, you know, we got elders from the village and me trying to teach the younger generation of this was how our forefathers have preserved their food. This they dug a deep hole in the land to put sweet potatoes, to put yams in times of cyclones, and then they cover it, and it could be there for 3 to 4 months. Those, you know, those are type of traditional knowledges that, with our limited resources, I wish to invest on so that the knowledges are still intact there in the communities. And I know I am running out of time, and I'm thankful to the teachers that they support me in my work. And putting the fish on firewood, open fire, and then having it for a meal with and our theme on the day was no processed food, not even salt. They cooked salt on their own. We got people who knew how to cook salt. You know, like trying to teach our children without processed food in times of crisis, this is how we can basically live back home.
Thank you.
Knowledge. And also, sorry, just one last one. With signs of disasters. So back home, we have our signs that our forefathers have taught us. These are signs of cyclones. I will not go into detail, like how breadfruit fruits, or how a banana tree will fruit as well, or how a beehive will be stationed, and maybe on the ground, or even on the ground, that is a sign there will be a cyclone. Okay, so these traditional knowledges, I'm all. Everywhere that I sit, maybe around a bowl of cover, I will be telling my friends and their children, see, this is, in the early days, this is how, these were early signs of cyclones. So if you see this, this is a warning of a cyclone. You know, all those knowledges is important to be passed down generation to generation. And back home, we have a way to a pattern of weaving a mat. So, you know, in all platforms I use to relay all these messages and trying to make sure that the knowledge is passed as quickly as possible, because I believe because of climate change, we are running against time. These knowledges have to be passed down to generations that are coming after.
I believe we've got some questions online.
Ask a question.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Do you think there are any opportunities to incorporate these traditional knowledges in innovation and disaster resilience, and kind of putting traditional knowledges at the forefront of those things and making that led by that, so that way those things are lost and they can continue to get passed down? And if they are changed, they're led by the community and how they're adapted.
I might just repeat that briefly because maybe for online listeners.
Sure.
So the question was, is there a way that traditional knowledge can be incorporated into innovation and into disaster response plans so that you know, it's a structural way, I suppose, to preserve that traditional knowledge. Mm. Do you see that being a way forward?
And not just incorporated, but actually
led
by that.
But yeah, that, correct. Yeah, not to be incorporated, but to be led by traditional knowledge. Mm.
I will be always speaking from examples. Back home, we have our votivo grass project led by the communities and no funding whatsoever from anyone. Because there is fast coastline erosion, we have been doing this for over a few years now, where it's village work for us to do once every month. Then we do vativa grass planting along the coastline, and we can see that it is working, and also mangrove planting. So when there is a big cyclone or continuous strong winds, where there is sea level rise to our villages. So these the areas where there is mangroves and vativa grass, they are not affected at all. So this is evidence that this is working. So it was our own initiative, and we were doing it out of our own resources.
Two things here. One, for traditional knowledge to such as this to be put on such stage as an innovative, first you need to acknowledge. A lot of times we often think global, act local. Usually we bring a lot of things, then we try and fit it in, and we introduce it to the communities. There are things that have worked in these communities in the past. When we talk about resiliency, we do have resilient crops that grow under the ground, that after every cyclone, these are the things that they go to. When there's shortage in food, our community know exactly where the wild hams do, and that's where they go to during those times. So those knowledge are available there, and so also the same for the First Nation people as well. Acknowledged by government, this is there. They need to be consulted on how it's going to be done. Second, we are often afraid to share this traditional knowledge as well, because at times the corporate do take it and change it and become something they can sell as well. So they put their brands on it and sell. So those are the two things that we need to look at when you're talking about traditional knowledge and how it's going to be practiced and how it's going to be introduced into the world.
I might just throw to a question online, and then I'll come to you.
Yeah, sure. So we've got a question from Patrick Coffey. Is that right? Question from the panel. In your countries, are you seeing public health impacts associated with climate change? For example, mosquito-borne diseases or waterborne pathogens? If so, can the WHO or WHO be another avenue for bringing pressure to bear on governments to increase their support for climate actions? So, yeah, links between climate change and public health impacts.
Maybe, yeah, Usa, you can speak to that too.
My wife is a nurse, a district nurse on the island. I can say first-hand experience of how things have changed. Anyone can jump into the sea way before. You go for swimming, you come back. Nowadays, we are developing irritations from the sea and even the sun. This never used to, I thought my skin was, now we're developing allergies as well, things that never used to happen before. Because of the change in food that they've just shared, a lot of our communities are now into processed food, and you will see NCD in most of our communities, even though they're surrounded by a lot of foods and things as well. We talk about nutrients that are coming from the sea. We don't have a lot of those anymore, as Zedi have clearly indicated as well. Our immune system and now it cannot withstand a lot of things that are coming. In the community that I live in, a flu that came around actually got three whole community down. We ran out of syringe on the first day. We ran out of needles on the second day. And this is still just on one island. these are things that never used to happen before. And when we talked about traditional knowledge, we don't acknowledge that there are gifts with the people in our community, medicinal things that as well. As I said, this kind of knowledge, we are afraid to share it because somebody will put their brand on it. Okay? And I will tell you a story about one of the community that was relocated itself. We often talked about the mana that share with the land. This community has the ability to put the bone back together. And they lost this, started to lose this as their community relocated to a new locations. Every country has a part to play in it, and every agency as well, WHO, has a part to play as well. Lavenia have just talked about the community, the nurse, district nurse chat as well. You know, if that is gone, it'll take Lavenia $70 each for the women to come to Lautoka to get children for their checkup, their immunizations and everything. And these are things that could have gone into better use as well. So all these agencies and all national, regional NGOs and community-based organizations have a lot to play in this as well.
Do you want to add?
With the question that came with the health aspect to climate change, of course, as like Usa had mentioned, there have been rising NCDs in the islands. I will honestly say that is true. At my island home, women and our moms and our dads are dying at the age of 50 and 60, but my grandfathers, they could be passing away at 70 and 80. I believe it is our eating habits. It is the way we live and the way we are eating now because of the poor production of our agriculture due to climate change. My people have turned into processed food. Every household in my village will definitely have a noodle meal in a day. So it was a threat to me as a community lead, and I've been working very quickly on my food security programs. Like I've mentioned, I did set up a EMC bank 3 years ago. I had found out that my grandfather's days, they had 12 species of yam back then, and came a time there was only two. So during COVID, I was looking around all over Fiji for the, where is the 10? And thanks to our partners, they have helped me with looking for the other 10 varieties. And at the moment we have 10, and I'm looking for another two. With no help from proper ministries, and that didn't weaken my strength of doing the work and looking for all these things. So now we started with 10 plots of each variety. Now our yam seed bank is producing close to 100 per species of yam, and it is a central seed bank that is supplying other villages to reproduce the species that we have in the central seed bank. And that is the same for our banana seed bank. We have about 8 species of banana now at home. And I used to hear of my grandfather say, bananas were ripe on the tree during our days, but your days, our youths will be looking around and searching who is the owner of this, and you know, they will be stealing. Come a time, it'll be like that. And then to me as a community lead, no, it's not supposed to be this way. We have this land to plant. And I've been working through the COVID period to reproduce bananas. When I go past a house and I see a tall banana tree standing and there are a few other shoots coming out, I'll be asking the house owner, you have four other shoots, can't you dig it out now and replant somewhere else? You know, it has gotten into my being that I'm supposed to be doing the work to help decrease NCDs in my communities.
We'll just take the one more question from the floor, and then we'll take the one online and we'll wrap up. But you're welcome. We've got some light refreshments and tea and coffee, so you're welcome to stick around as long as you like and speak directly if you've got anything to follow up on. Thank you.
You might have addressed this early because I was a little bit late. I'm sorry about that. But I'm wondering what sort of how well you think these concerns of yours are represented by your own governments, and then what relationship do activists like you have, and what sort of communication do you have, direct communication with your own, the powerful in your country?
What's to start? I know you all have something to say about this.
I know you're different, you know, I know there's different circumstances.
I'll speak for the Fiji Council of Social Services. I talked about the 18 district councils, and under that we have the 280 community-based organizations that are there. As soon as we got back, I have a plan with Lavenia to go and establish the Usaia District Council of Social Services. What we've done in the last few years is just like what Oxfam have done for Fiji and us that are here. The space that usually occupied by national CSOs and NGOs, we open it for community to actually come and sit with government to look at changing policy. They are the ones that are going through it. They might as well be the one then come will tell their story at the national level. In the last few years, we've been building this, and we have become movers and seekers. And this, I'm telling you, these are the ones that live in community. I live in Moala, all the way to the east, and it'll take you 12 hours to go to my island, and coming around to three other islands, it'll take you 5 days to reach Suva. I have to climb a mountain to put in my applications to be here. I sit in the National Employment Center as one of the board members and appointed last month. From the community, to be able to see it at that level. We do have our executive director that sit at the physical review committee. These are the ones that look at governments and their budget. We have somebody that lives in the village of Nakasaleka in Kandabu that now sits at the Fiji elections committee. We have a lady who was our past president that are now sits at the constitution commission. These are the little spaces that we are slowly going to, so that we make sure that the voice of those in the community are heard at this level. That is the start. We would like government to start committing a lot of this in terms of their budget in how it's materializing in community and its program as well. And we're pushing towards that a lot. Government have its own priorities as well, and this is something that we're working with. We'll continue to knock on doors nationally, and we're doing now internationally as well, in hoping that these stories where there'll be a lot of more political will. We've just had a change of government for such a long time, and so are yours as well. And in the last 16 years, a lot of us in the community in Fiji have to self-censor because we are afraid to be that we might be prosecuted for anything that we say. It took a lot for those that are here in Australia and other nations, because they were able to express themselves freely and keep pushing our government. These are the voice that reach the communities out there for them to make changes in the last government. Now we have another opportunity to again to get together for that. We need the national, the regional, and the international to keep amplifying the needs in the community so changes can come internationally, regionally, and to the national as well. We might be able to to influence some, but sometimes some of this negotiation is done bilaterally as well, and we have opportunity as well to sit with some of these parliamentarians and tell them what is the reality. You might be hearing something from my leader, but this, I'm telling you the stories from where I am from. And I'm hoping that not only that you help us as well, but also influencing my government, because a lot of time we are talking to brick walls. And I'm hoping that these are the things that we continue to do in the next few years as well.
Well, me as a young person growing up, who just graduated from high school, growing up to someone who's in power, who has money, and they say, hey, I need help, let's be real. Do you think that he's gonna want to listen to me? But with my with this platform Oxfam has given to me, I hope it makes an earthquake in the politician house in the Solomon Islands, so that they can see like, oh no, this is the kid we rejected when he was you know? Like he said, Australia is a big sister, yeah? So I'm gonna be the tattletale who comes here and be like, this guy is not doing his job, and they're probably gonna broadcast there, and then some politicians may take us youths in the South Pacific more seriously, you know? So I'm very grateful for this opportunity, and I hope this will be the platform that will open waves of Pacific Island youths to fight and to also speak to politicians who think that this money is for me now, and instead for funding it to the grassroots community. Thank you very much.
You'd like to hear me as well?
Yes. For me, honestly, the position of a district representative, I work for the government, and I will honestly tell you, maybe because some people may be watching online as well, and the government of Fiji pays me $800 for 3 months, my fuel allowances. So I'm least bothered for that $800 if it still cancel it tonight after this. But I will honestly say that with the previous government, I had a hard time. With this one, I would be writing emails to any minister and I'll ask him, can I have an appointment with you? Because I need this project to be implemented. And it will be definitely a yes. Tell me the day you are coming. The title of the only woman district representative in Fiji maybe is that is the key to the doors. And even with our divisional heads in our main city, when I will write in a request or if I call, I have this project in line, blah, blah, blah. I said, oh my God, it's this. You know, that district representative is calling and we'll have to look into it because if not, she'll be making noises. That's how it is with me back home. And I'm making sure with my projects, I'm following up all the time so that they know I'm in business as well. The climate change impact happening on the ground is real and it's urgent, especially with my water projects. The water sources are drying everywhere and I need, the interventions that we had with CEOs, one of them came to me and asked, what is your scoping like for one of those water sources? Because the story about my sons, me dreaming about my sons fetching out water and there was no water hit them on the spot, that there is urgency in the communities. So instead of committing to national interest, maybe there is a room for funding community-based projects on the ground and not funding at the government level, and funds are sitting there at their own interest.
Thank you. I will go to the last question online. I might encourage people to give. We'll see what the question is, but maybe we'll have short answers so we can have a break and have something.
Sure. So this question comes from Josie Lee. One of the big opportunities at the next COP is the establishment of the Loss and Damage Fund for people most adversely affected or impacted by climate change. Can you talk to the importance of this fund for your community and what you would want this fund to deliver?
Yeah, so it would be great to hear from each of you, and yeah, maybe if you could think of, you know, exactly one or two things you would like to see adequate loss and damage funding deliver for your community.
I will go first.
Yeah, and we'll go down the line.
Women's first.
Ladies first.
Ladies first.
Yeah.
Okay, for me, with the loss and damage funding, my priority is water. Yeah, because water is vital for living. And I believe four of my communities back home have no proper water management system. Even the water sources are not dammed so that we store water for our everyday use. And not even our houses have rainwater harvest tanks to store clean drinking water. So this is where I want the loss and damage funds to go to. And that is my priority on the table while in Canberra next week.
With these funds, I would make sure to help our community, grassroots community, be able to have food security. And not only that, to preserve our traditional knowledges and to be able to educate our indigenous Solomon Islanders. Because if we were to practice traditional knowledges, who are the ones that are going to practice those traditional knowledges? And then be more open and more inclusive when it comes to more hearings of climate change and the environment, and ask more youth to be involved in this type of things. Thank you very much.
This is a totally new topic for me. When it comes to climate change, we've always talked about mitigations and adaptations. Loss and damage, I heard it 2 weeks ago in Kiowa. I was in Kiowa with the Rainbow Warrior, where the Greenpeace visited us. And I heard loss and damage, so I had to ask around what loss and damage is. So one of the lady I had to sit for 2 or 3 hours of grog so that I can learn what loss and damage is. A lot of these things that have happened can be replaced. The seawall can be rebuilt. The footpath, it can be rebuilt. You have the houses that get blown down, can be built up in the next few days. But there are things that cannot be replaced. In one of the community in Moala, in the last high tide, children and elders have to go to the beach to pick up the bones of their ancestors because the water start going into their burial ground. These are the things that are sacred to them. How do we compensate for that? There are things that the effect has happened because of climate change that we cannot put a monetary value on it. And these are the kind of loss that we need to start looking at as well. And I know Australia have said yes to this, but they haven't really commit to it. Maybe it's time that we have this platform where communities and every stakeholders will come and sit, start looking at the things that we have lost that are caused by climate change, that we need to show them. Because from the little I know of what loss and damage is, it outweighs all climate financings and everything that they've contributed so far. Because there are things that are cultural, that are close to us. Traditionally, it means our identity. And these are the things that we're losing day by day. We live in fear because of the uncertainty on what's coming on November to April. Not sure if it's going to be rain, monsoon, or a hurricane, category 5 or category 6. And we are not sure what we will lose. Maybe it's the next species of fish from Solomon. Maybe it's the next yam from Misawa, and maybe it's something totally different. And come next year, it's planning all over again. We cannot go through this over and over again and thinking that we'll come through it unscathed. No. Prevention is always better than cure. And it's about time we come together to work towards a solution. For those that are there in the community, for those that make decisions, and for those that are here in the middle that are
providing bridges for this to happen. And I thank Oxfam and those of you that are here for your time and allowing us to be here in Australia creating these spaces and allowing us to come and voice our stories. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that, those powerful words to finish, Usaia. I wanted to take this moment, thank you very much for acknowledging Gadigal land, Usaia, because that was something I did not do at the start, which was very remiss of me. So I want to acknowledge the land of the Gadigal people and thank them for us being able to come here and have this discussion tonight. And I think I'm going to ban all of you from thanking Oxfam anymore. It is us who are so blessed to have you here, because your experience, your knowledge, it just cannot be replaced. And these are the words that we all have to hear, that Australia needs to understand, so that we can respond appropriately to the level of threat, the level of damage, the level of change that's facing us. As I said, everybody who's here, you're welcome to join us for some refreshments just outside. You would have walked past the tea and coffee table. I'm assuming that's where the food is. For everybody online, there was dozens of people online for those in the room. So, I think, there is a gathering awareness of, that climate justice has to be a key part of the fight to address climate change. So thank you to everybody online. We'll say goodnight to you now. And thank you to everybody in the room for coming. And one last huge round of applause for our amazing speakers.